Good evening. Welcome to Whaler Sports TV, TV 99. Dick Herman here, Gino on camera, Rick doing the calling. We're watching the girls get checked out by the officials. I'd like to mention all our fine sponsors who bring you Whaler Sports on Gino TV, Congdon & Coleman Insurance, Killen Real Estate, Nantucket Pharmacy, Island Pharmacy, Santos Rubbish Removal, Harborview Oil Corporation, Nantucket Airlines, Egan Institute, Peter Beaton Hat Studio, Pete's Fresh, Fish Prince, Grey Lady Insurance, the UPS Store, Nantucket Booster Club, Greg Rath Builder, Nantucket Tackle Center, the Downey Flake, Sherman Management, Brock Insurance, the Sea Grill, Don Allen Auto Center, Rick's Paint and Maintenance, Lady Bird Lingerie, Cavalier Gallery, Joe Rapacki CPA, Ithan Lumber, Martin Bork Painting, Cowboys Meat Market, Stova Engineering, Cam Appliance, Island Carpets, Nantucket Parcel Plus, TNT Water Sprinkling, The Island, The Package Store, Connor Electric, Valero & Sons Garden Center, James Lydon Sons & Daughter Roofing, Trestle To Go, Fast Forward, Nantucket Seafood, Hawthorne Guest House, Rideau Electric, Nantucket Shellfish Association, Kitty Murtaugs, Nantucket Boys & Girls Club, Outdoor Power, Just Do It 2 Sport Fishing, The Dog Wash, Fairgrounds Restaurant, Boathouse Restaurant, Cottage & Castle, The Beauty Bar, Nantucket Electrical Contractors, Champion Rentals, The Steamship Authority, Nantucket Trees Landscaping, Highland Floor Finishing and Painting, Sun Island Fuel, Cape Air, Billy Built Auto Repair, Fawcett Man, and Gino TV. We thank all these fine sponsors for bringing you portions of today's game. We welcome Rick Blair into the booth. How are you doing today, Rick?
Quite well, Dick. How are you?
Good. Now, do you know how the girls' game is played? Do you got any familiarity with it?
Yeah, my high school had a really good girls' team, actually, back when, that's a long time ago. And so I watched it growing up, although I will admit that the rules still bewilder me at times. But clearly, it's a different game, but it's a great transition sport, just like men's lacrosse is.
I got a quick question, though, before we begin about when they were checking the sticks out. What could the girls possibly do to their stick that would give them an advantage? Why does the referee always check every stick?
The girls' sticks are the similar to the rules with the men's sticks. The pockets have to be a certain dimension so the ball will not, so the ball can be dislodged. And the men's sticks, especially these days, the rules used to be that you couldn't see the top of the ball when you held the stick parallel to your eyes. But now, even though that's still the rule, the stick design has changed to the point where it's very difficult to dislodge the ball from a men's stick. The girls' sticks have virtually no pocket. And that's why the cradling style is different. They hold their sticks more upright. And of course, because there's not much physical contact in the girls' game, if the ball were to get really lodged in there, it would just never come out. And if you watch university level or international women's lacrosse, that is kind of a problem for the sport because they have such big, fast athletes that it's impossible to get to stop them because you're not really allowed to be too physical.
Okay. Everybody's trying to get an advantage, Gino, wherever they can.
Dog eat dog.
Now, I don't know if there's any rule changes from last year to this year in the girls' side, but the big difference I always saw, well, the two big differences I saw between the boys and the girls at the high school level here was the girls can't check as much as the boys.
Right.
So sometimes a game can really be dominated by one person.
That's
one
right.
Young lady on either team can get that ball and just fly up the other end, and they really can't check her and get the ball away from her.
Yeah, that's
like that.
There she is.
Oh, and it hit the post, I think.
43, Catherine Pittman.
It hit the goalie in the leg. She didn't even know the shot was coming, No, Nantucket looks to be, after 30 seconds, Nantucket looks to be the better team.
Who is this team anyway?
This is Cape Cod Academy.
Okay.
And they've actually fielded some good teams. They've given us fits over the years, to be honest with you. I just know that because I used to be in close contact with Amy and Heather Williams when they were coaching here, and I can recall us losing a number of times to this team.
Look at that.
The Cape Cod Academy goalie is not very active down there already. The first shot hit her in the knee pads for the save. That shot there went right by her before she even moved. So Nantucket has a Big advantage. Who got that goal?
You know, you'll have to forgive me for a second.
Number 13. I think that's, is that Pittman?
Pittman?
No, she's 43.
Oh, 43 then. That's what I meant.
They've actually changed some of their jersey numbers today, so Coach Asano was nice enough to correct the roster, but it's a little bit confusing right now until we get a little further along.
Yeah, Tucker coming into this game 2-0, and they're off to a quick 1-0 lead here. And, again, they get the ball. Catherine wins the face off again and walks it right down.
Comes up again, yeah.
The second major difference between the boys and the girls is that they don't really shut the clock off for the girls.
Right. It's running
time. It's just running. I mean, the ball has to almost get to the Seagull before they finally turn the clock off and call them back.
Well, in the old days, that's Emma Pierce on the shot, number 28. Prior to about 20 years ago, the girls' field did not have sidelines. They would just run and run.
I remember that. Yeah, I remember them once playing the ball off the field house. The ball hit the field house, and they said, oh, play's dead. The ball's out of play, and boom.
Yep.
It was right back in the field, and they kept running with it.
Yep. This is
Oh, boy.
You know what I'm going to tell you, Rick? What I think why a lot of the jersey numbers got changed for today is that they probably brought up a lot of JV girls to get into this game.
That's
later.
A very good point, Dick.
I think there's a lot of young girls down there that haven't played any this year, and they're going to get
Pierce,
their chance
today.
Emma
Pierce, the crease.
Oh, she was in the crease.
Looks like Catherine stepped in the crease that time.
And the girls play two halves rather than four quarters. A little bit of a difference there. So the game moves along a little bit quicker because you don't have the natural break at the end of the first quarter to the second.
Right. And they're also not constantly subbing through the box the way they do in the men's game.
Pittman walks in for her second.
Again.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. When you see a situation like this, I often wonder with women's lacrosse, if I'm coaching Cape Cod Academy, I might say to myself, well, you know, we're just trying to learn here. Maybe we should play a zone. And that way you will eliminate the situations where somebody loses track of the person they're supposed to be covering, and she walks right in like she did that time. At least with a zone, someone's going to be in that area.
Poor Cape Cod, who's only got one sub down there.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
They are a rebuilding year, I have a feeling. Can your camera hold it up for 20 goals? You know, I think this might be a 20.
You really think so?
Well, Nantucket scored 17 and 16.
Do they have a slaughter rule?
Huh?
Sydney Strait taking the face off for Nantucket. I hope I'm pronouncing her name right.
Well, the slaughter rule in boys across is they keep the clock running, but they keep the clock running here anyways.
No, not after a goal they don't.
Well, maybe in the slaughter rule they'll keep it running after the goal.
See. Yeah.
Sarah Dahmy there on the wing.
It's Gino's birthday tomorrow, so this is an early birthday present for you, Gino. The girls are going to win for you.
Well, that's...
Yeah. I heard him talking about that.
This one's for Gino.
Well, that's why when we decided to do Monday or Tuesday, I think Gino went for Monday because he probably has plans tomorrow with Harry, Harry and birthday
Sydney Strait, Sarah Dahmy. And here's Sydney Strait looking like she was running.
What was wrong with that?
She was running unimpeded to the goal, and I don't know what the call was. Now she appears to have been fouled inside the 8-meter fan, the inner arc there, which means that she's going to get a penalty shot unimpeded.
This is a real tough situation for the goalie.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
So Nantucket has a quick 3-0 lead here. And
that was Cindy Strait, I believe, that scored that goal. Strait.
Number 38 on your program.
Yep. Let's see who's out there now.
So now you have a tough situation for the Nantucket coach. He's going to be happy getting his younger kids in, but you know the starters, the seniors, They want to get some playing time too.
Right.
And Sydney takes the...
You're not allowed to kick it.
They have, I was talking to the official before the game, and they have apparently different, as is the case to some degree in men's lacrosse, different associations, different private school rules, public school rules, youth rules, and in some of those, situations like this one, you're not allowed to kick it. I guess you are allowed to kick it at the college level.
And boys can kick it.
Oh, yeah. Kayo Correa used to kick it all the time when he played.
Oh, wow.
Trying to feed the center. Cape Cod Academy comes up with their first ground ball of the game.
That's good.
Nice play there.
First time
they're
going to get it into the end of the field.
This young lady looks like she's got some speed. And that might be that one person you were talking about, Dick.
Yeah, if they have a couple of girls that with speed, and here she goes.
Number seven, Carolyn.
Beat one more. She's going to walk right
Carolyn
in there.
Carolyn Thompson, she's a sophomore. Looks like she's might be their featured player for sure.
Oh, big save there. She walked right in. Save
by Emma Chambers. Sam Chambers' daughter in the Nets. He was here warming her up before the game.
But that young lady did move right in there. Got nice two shots, but the Nantucket goalie makes two big saves here. Yes. We're here in the first period, portion of the first period, brought to us by Fairgrounds. Well, where the fans are welcome at the Fairgrounds, where friends meet and sports are on the TVs. 19:30 to go in the first half. They're talking about the 3-0 lead here, but Cape Cod trying to get on the scoring sheet.
It appears that Carolyn there was interfered with or fouled inside the 12-meter arc, so she'll get a free possession there. Nantucket will be able to go contest her as soon as the whistle blows. They have to stand behind that arc, though, before they start the play.
What happened there? She blew it again. Oh, my goodness. Is the clock still going? Yes, it is, sir.
Somebody must have moved early or something of that nature. Yep. They're going to replay it.
Another 2 minutes will tick off the clock here as they position every player again.
Wow.
Another save.
Another save by Emma. That was a nice save.
It really was.
She had to move across her body. It was a good shot.
Well,
high and offside. That's always the toughest save for a goalkeeper, men's or women's, when you have to step to your offside with your stick and move it across your body. Of course, they always tell men and women not to shoot stick side and high to the goalie. That's the easiest save.
Emma Chambers, I have her on my roster here is 25. The goalie, what number do you have the goalie in your roster? I'm confused on this.
The Nantucket goalie?
Yeah.
Emma's number 25, yep.
And that's not who's in goal right now.
Well, she must be wearing a different jersey because that is her.
That is her, okay. So she's wearing 26 there today, okay.
Yeah. Well, 25, 26, you know.
She's only a freshman.
Yep.
That's a good sign.
She's a good swimmer. Number 30, Christina Rogovin, advancing the ball up the field. Now number 25.
Oh, what a great pass. And oh, another score.
You know, Cape Cod Academy's goalie is just really not in the ready position.
No.
You know, you really want to get down in an athletic stance and just have that stick up at shoulder level and your arms a little bit extended.
Who got that one?
I didn't see.
Dennis, what number got that one? Did you see?
I don't know. I didn't
see it. Raph, who got that goal? Who?
Alexa Aloisi.
Thank you. Alexa Aloisi scored. Got that information.
Talking to Coach Asona, he was telling me that typically they have specific positions assigned to each player in the women's game, first home, second home, third home, and so forth. But he's telling me that the way the game's being played today, it's really more just divided up into offensive and defensive players. They don't necessarily specify what each specific player has to do and where they have to be in terms of the strategy.
Well, he certainly has the girls off to a flying start here. They're 2-0 coming into this game, and we can be pretty assured they're going to win this one. So they're going to go to 3-0. That's a great start for the Raf Sana, who's the new head coach of the girls lacrosse team this year.
Yeah, Raf coached the girls in 2012, and I think 2012 and 13, and then was away for a while, and now he's back, which... It's always good to have good, hardworking, committed coaches, and he certainly fits that description. He was telling me that their toughest competition is probably going to come from Falmouth Academy, Sandwich, and Martha's Vineyard. And they'll be playing a lot of those games a little shorthanded because of over spring vacation.
Well, when is spring vacation anyway?
I believe it starts next week.
Friday's the last day of school, and then the school will shut down next week. Yeah.
It is?
Yeah, so the kids, when the kids go away, some of them are school-sponsored trips, and then some of them are just parents. And so it's difficult to schedule games. You want to schedule games, but you want to have as many as your players there for the games, too.
I didn't realize it was this Friday.
Well, you almost have to schedule games to get in a full, full docket of games. And, it's always, especially, every other year they have the Europe trip, and that happens to be this year, which is a great experience for the kids. But as you say, it can be a little problematic. Oh, off the pipe.
Where are they going this year in their trip?
The Spanish club's going over, I believe.
I believe to Spain. It should be Spain then, assume.
Yeah.
Oh, look at this. Wow. What's wrong with that? She got it. So, wow, Dick.
They're just firing them in there, left and right. That was Lauren Bissett with that one.
I don't see. Was that number 7?
I thought it was 37.
37, okay.
That's what I saw.
37, Lucy Brissett, yeah. And that's just this number situation, folks at home, please bear with us because it's...
I have Lauren as 37. I don't have a number for Lucy. Do you have a number for Lucy or Lauren?
My roster says Lucy is 37.
Lucy is 37. We apologize, but we're doing what we can. 38.
28. Oh, my gosh. Number 6, Dick.
Was that Kaylee Waters?
You said it. It probably will be 24.
I had 38 with that one.
38, okay.
So I had two goals for Sydney, goals for Catherine, one for Lauren, and one for Alexa. So.
Yeah, once again, I really think if Cape Cod Academy just played some basic zone strategy in front of that goal, they wouldn't be giving up these uncontested shots.
Yeah, they didn't get some bodies in front there because right now Nantucket's getting wide open looks and the goalie is not that mobile to stop them. So she needs some of her defensemen around her to help clog the area a bit.
Yeah.
Okay.
Boy, fast and furious.
That makes it number 7, Dick.
What number got that one?
Was it 15?
I heard them saying yay, Maggie.
They're taking a timeout now.
Yep. Maggie Visco. All right.
What can Cape Cod Academy do?
Cape Cod Academy can absolutely do zero to stop Nantucket with the offense they got. What Rick said can help a little bit around the goal. It's not going to solve the problem, but right now Nantucket's just getting completely open shots. I have a feeling the timeout by the Nantucket coach is going to go to... You don't want to say don't try to score, but sometimes you play a little game with your kids and you say, okay, you're going to make 5 passes before you take the shot.
Or, there's different types
right.
of
Does that make sense, Rick?
Yeah.
What different types of offense you can work on, too. If in the men's game, I'm sure it's the same with the girls. You can have people operate behind the goal and exchange the ball behind the goal and look to feed cutters. Yeah. And that way, you can sort of hang on to the ball, kill some clock, and actually get something out of it for yourselves and for them.
I can remember a basketball coach saying to us in a situation like this here, he said, yeah, we're going to see who, we're going to keep track of who scores, but he said he would, you know, treat the high scorer or the MVP of the game to a pizza or something. He said, I'm going to buy the pizza for the guys with the most assists tonight.
Right.
So, you know, let's pass the ball three or four times. Let's keep track of the assists tonight. Right. As being a big stat, you know, and that's what you can tell your girl.
Never stop coaching.
And they need to practice in the passing. We saw that in the men's game on Saturday where North Reading really threw the ball around and Nantucket was at a disadvantage throwing the ball around.
Yeah. That game, the more I thought about that after that night, we're just very young.
Yes.
Very young.
All right, so Nantucket, 14 to go here in the first half, has got a commanding 7-0 lead.
You can't touch her. That's the whole idea here. You cannot hit the stick.
Right. And what you do, you get the whistle like that.
You can hit the stick when it's not within what the officials call the sphere around your opponent's head.
I see.
As long as that stick is tucked in close to her head, you can't check it. Now, if she drops it down, then you can check it, and you can check from below and dislodge check up on the stick and dislodge the ball that way. That's a nice play.
There's a nice goal there.
Number 12, Leela Way from Pocasset, Massachusetts.
And they're watching. They'll be watching, Dick.
And she's only
in Pocasset. Hello to our folks in Pocasset.
And she's only a freshman.
Only a freshman. Puts it in. Nice little move there. She went around the back of the net, came out, and got the shot off nicely. And so Cape Cod is on the scoreboard here.
You know, I might be incorrect about what class she's in. It seems to...
Just so you know, guys.
Oh, okay.
The game, boys game, just went on yesterday, and it's got 106 hits. So a lot of those kids are watching from over in North Reading, too, I'm sure.
That goal was brought to us by Island Lumber. They cover the island for over 50 years.
Number 7 again, Carolyn Thompson, resident of Harwich. Or as they say, Harwich. Carolyn's looking to move and operate herself. It doesn't appear that she's looking to pass.
Oh, that was a nice
top corner shot. And you know, it's so similar to the way what you talk about with the men's game. When an offensive player can get to the center of the field, then they have both sides of the goal to shoot at, and they can shoot with either hand. See, as a defender, you want to channel them to one side of the goal or the other, so they can only shoot with one angle. And the further they run, the less angle they have to shoot. And once they're in the center of the field, it's very difficult to defend.
That goal brought to us by Don Allen Auto Center. New and used vehicles on sale at Don Allen. Come out and check out the 2017s. Big savings, serving Nantucket since 1967.
Alexa Aloisi took that face off.
Yeah, we've seen two or three different girls there already now, so some of the girls getting a chance
Wow. And once again.
That's 7-3 now.
You guys are speaking too soon.
And every time Cape Cod scores, I see another starter get up off the bench and go back in.
Yeah.
It's more counted, though.
I remember.
So it might be a penalty, too.
So Cape Cod has come back with 3 unanswered goals. That goal was brought to us by Harbor Fuel Oil Corporation. Get your fuel delivered. 228-2411. Check them out online at harborfuel.com.
Carolyn Thompson's going to take this face off.
She gets it all by herself.
There must have been a penalty after the shot.
They could be right back in this game.
This would be real interesting if 7 motors down the field and pumps it in a hurry, right? I agree with you, Gino.
Now what happened?
Looks like someone left too early on the...
She's not going to motor down the field with that whistle being blown. Now she took the ball out of the girl's stick. And what is she going to do with it? They need the ball to continue playing. Now they're going to put it back in there. So that's a little formality that I did not understand.
Carolyn Thompson again, being guarded by Alexa Aloisi, if the roster's correct.
Alexa gets it away from her.
Yeah, but looks like Carolyn's going to get it back. Nope, right to a Nantucket player. Number 30. Christina Rogovin, number 30, comes up with it.
Bissett moving up the field. She has a goal already.
Nantucket really has not put the ball behind the goal much today. Doesn't seem like they want to employ the cutting game.
Whistle blown before the shot was taken. The shot did go in, but the whistle was well before the shot. Let's see what the call is. This official here does a lot of talking down there. She takes.
So that was that.
She takes the play away from the Whalers.
Look at that! Look, they just stand there next to her. Oh, so she could take it. She did touch the stick that time.
She checked up on the stick when it was down at her waist level. Number one,
KD
Trnovich.
Bangs that one home.
Well, I mean, I'm not sure that the Cape Cod Academy goalkeeper has a save yet.
No.
And well, she does.
She does. The first yeah, shot of the day hit her in the pad. Hit her in the leg, right. But she never saw it coming. It was one of those, oops, something hit me.
Yeah. It would appear that that's going to be, even if the game is evenly played, Nantucket has a big advantage in that situation. We're almost at the 11-minute mark here.
In the first half, though,
yep.
Right?
Yep.
Yeah, they play two halves, Gino.
Just for people that might be thinking it's
might be
second
thinking
half.
Second half. If you're just tuning in, it's been all your Nantucket Whalers
Alexa,
for the first 14 minutes,
the
8
face
to 3.
Off. Maggie Visco comes up with the ball. Looks like she's looking to move the ball out to a wing. Now it's up top.
Well, Nantucket doesn't do a lot of passing.
Look at that. Just let her come right in.
And they blow the whistle again before she gets in there. They must be calling some type of an offside or something. I don't.
Well, you're not allowed to impede her progress from the side inside the 8-meter fan, they call it.
Well, this penalty's against Cape Cod. Last time they took the ball away from the Whalers in the same situation.
So this is Maggie Visco. It looks like she's going to get an awfully good opportunity here. And she does.
Oh my gosh,
nope, they blew the whistle again.
They're not going to count that?
Yeah, they say, you just say goal's good, let's have a face-off. They make it do it all over again. I don't understand that at all. So Nantucket gets penalized because Cape Cod was penalized.
Right. Well, you know, I think a lot of this is...
She did get a stick on that one, but it rolled in. It looked like she was going to have her second save, but Maggie gets her second goal.
I think it's really interesting to note that as compared to some of the girls' teams I've seen here in the past, we're not doing a lot of, as you say, we're not doing a lot of cutting. We're not operating much from the wings or behind the goal, which you can't help wondering if against a better team that might.
Oh, it's very little pitch and catch, you know?
Yeah, I mean,
whoever gets the ball pretty much goes down there, works itself in, and gets the goal, which they can do today, and they won't do it, as you say, against a good team.
Right. I think Coach Osona probably would like to see them work on the cutting game a little bit more because they'll need it against the good opponents.
This face-off brought to us by Nantucket Airlines. We're all about the islands. Call now for reservations, 228-6234.
Sydney straight again.
She has a couple already.
Yeah, she's been all over the field today.
Now what? Every time they run to the
Anna DiCarlo there.
There must be a magic button there. As soon as they step over, the whistle blows, because every time they get in that position, there's a call.
Yeah, they're impeding her. They're impeding her progress. Illegally, but I didn't really see it that time.
Oh, this is second save.
I guess we got a really young son.
Young girl coming in. Yeah, she looks like she's a middle school kid almost, possibly an eighth grader.
Nice shot that time. That was actually a really pretty bounce shot. Goalie's offside. I think even the really experienced keeper probably wouldn't have made that save.
No, that's Harry's age. That's 11 years old right there.
That's Paige Albertson scoring a goal there.
Paige gets it for us today.
She tucked it right inside that right pipe. Goalie's left.
We see a number seven coming in, and we're thinking this young lady coming in is probably of the middle school variety.
Maybe middle school. We'll keep an eye on her.
There's no JV game today. A lot of the JVs are dressed for the Nantucket varsity team. Cape Cod Academy doesn't have enough for a JV team, I'm assuming. They only have one sub here for the varsity today.
Looks like Catherine Pittman's going to face off again. I think that's her.
The Boston Globe edition yesterday had their All Scholastics for the winter season. It's always a nice thing to look and read. They always put the 10 top stories, and one of the top stories was the Needham girls ice hockey team. Started out the year with 13 girls. They lost two in the first two or three games to injuries. So they finished just with 11 skaters plus their goalkeeper, and they made it all the way to the finals. And if you think ice hockey, we're talking about a team with not many subs. Needham did not have many subs for all their games, and they kept on winning.
Wow.
Kaylee Wooters gets it inside. Nice effort there by the Whalers. Nina Wilson.
I think. But they didn't win the final.
No, they lost the final game, yeah.
If they had their other two players?
That's a possibility, yeah.
It's just unbelievable.
Yeah, so they're basically going with two lines and two sets of defensemen. Then they got trying to come out from behind the net there, not working that time.
I believe that's number 50, Nina Wilson. I can read the numbers from here. Yep, that's her. She showed a little burst there coming around that left-hand side. Looks as though she's a natural lefty. Here we go, getting the ball behind the goal. I think that's a good move for the Whalers.
Yeah, they should practice that, right?
Exactly.
I mean, so much of what you see in women's lacrosse, when you watch at the college level, does initiate from behind the goal.
Three saves for the young lady from Cape Cod Academy.
Oh, boy. Oh, that's...
Trying to clear it out. The interception by...
That's Nina Wilson again.
Nina Wilson, and she's persistent, and she hung around the net, and she gets her first goal from it on the turnover. Face-off coming up, brought to us by Congdon & Coleman Insurance, specializing in personal and commercial lines of insurance. Auto Home Marine Business, established 1931 down at 57 Main Street.
You know, over the years, looking at the women's lacrosse scores, Dick, at the high school level in Massachusetts, you frequently see some very lopsided scores. And I mean, some of these coaches must be pretty pretty bloodthirsty because some of these scores, you know, it's not that unusual to see scores in the 20s against teams that only score three or four.
Yeah, it's the one thing I dislike in a sporting event is when a team tries to rub it in when they pretty much have the contest won, no matter what sport you're playing. You know, they go for that extra touchdown at the end. They're firing up three-pointers in a basketball game at the end, you know?
Well, three-pointers are a little different.
Well, not if you got a team sitting back on their heels and you got a guy who's red hot, you know?
You hate to tell a guy that's hitting three-pointers not to
Not to shoot.
To be hot.
How about that Celtics game about 2 weeks ago where a second-year player threw in 70 points?
Oh, the guy on the Phoenix team.
Team. I never heard of this guy. And
he had had another big game prior to that, too.
But
like
I mean,
56 point.
But I never heard of this guy.
I know.
The name meant nothing to me. And all of a sudden, I'm watching a little bit of the game, and then I'm looking at the news the next day, and I'm saying, this guy is unbelievable here.
That was exciting for him.
Here comes Carolyn Thompson again, guys.
Larry Bird never threw in 70 at the Boston Garden.
What's going on with Carolyn? Oh, she got a penalty on that.
Catherine Pittman looks like she was penalized.
So Cape Cod got a man up here. Let's see if they can take advantage of it. They got the ball and the man
up at the Vineyard. Nantucket's going to drop into a zone here. In there.
The Vineyard.
That was good.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, listening to you guys talk about the Celtics got me all confused. But Nantucket's in a zone defense right now in their man down situation.
I don't think we have too many people on the Vineyard watching us today.
Yeah, right.
Maybe this weekend. I think Vineyard's coming over here.
Yeah, Carolyn.
Is the Vineyard coming here?
They're on a schedule for some game. I forget now which game it is.
It's a lacrosse game?
Carolyn Thompson again. She's definitely their go-to player.
Yeah, this Saturday. This Saturday, the boys are going to the Vineyard away, and the girls are going to play the Vineyard this Saturday, the 15th, 1 o'clock game.
Okay.
So that's what Rick's trying to tell us about. The Vineyard is coming.
Well, Carolyn Thompson scores, I think, her third goal to make it an 11-4 contest. You talk about speaking too soon. You know, I can recall 1 year, but Bishop Connolly had a pretty weak team, and the boys' team was on a roll. And Matt Fee convinced me to start the second string because they deserve to have a chance, and we darn near lost. So you have to be careful what you wish for.
Oh, yeah. Well, Nantucket was playing Cape Tech in football, and they got up like 30-0, and then Vito puts the second team in there the second half, and all of a sudden it's like 30-26, and he didn't want to put the first team back in. He wanted the second team to pull it out, and they hung on, but it was hairy at the end, yeah.
Number five there. That was a nice play by Mia Blackwell.
So Mia gets in for her first of the day. One thing Nantucket is doing is spreading the scoring around. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 9 different girls have already scored. That goal was brought to us by the Seagrill. Check out the Seagrill. 9 at 9. $9 bar menus at both bars Friday and Saturday nights. The Seagrill. Open for lunch Monday to Saturday. Dinner Monday to Saturday. Closed on Sundays.
9 at 9.
For me, it's 9 Z's at 9.
Is that right?
I'm nodding off. Yeah, he's.
You cannot stay awake.
I don't want to. I get ready for bed at 9. I'm asleep by 9:30.
There was some great NCAA lacrosse on television yesterday.
Oh, yes.
How'd those games come out? I was thinking about it. You're telling us.
Johns Hopkins lost to Ohio State in a fairly close game. It was at Ohio State. The Big Ten's really been great this year. And then in the ACC, Virginia lost to somewhat surprisingly, I believe, to North Carolina.
Yeah, I would say both those games are sort of on the upset variety, right?
Well, Carolina's the defending national champion, but they graduated a lot. They lost a couple guys and dropped out. But the Big Ten is solid top to bottom this year. It's Big Ten in the ACC, pretty much, and Denver.
Now, how did a local school, I think the Rhode Island, Bryant, how did they get so good in such a hurry?
They hired Mike Pressler. He was the former coach. He was the coach at Duke during the scandal.
Okay.
And he's also the coach of Team USA.
Yeah.
And he's a great coach. And, of course, you know, he was wrongly smeared in that whole thing and ended up settling with Duke for a whole lot of money, I'm sure. But he's regarded as one of the best coaches in the game. And when he went there, they went from being a Division II team to Division I, and everybody wants to play for Pressler.
So, just overnight, they came out of nowhere, right? Yeah. That's a good point. I didn't know that. But all of a sudden, you know, I sort of follow the scores in the paper and look, and all of a sudden I'm seeing this Bryant, and last year they were in the tournament, right? Yeah. And I'm saying, why are they in the tournament? Where'd they come from? I thought they were a Division II. So how many years ago did they go from Division II to Division I?
He's been there, I'm going to say, 7 or 8 years at least.
It's been that long since that scandal. Yeah, I remember that scandal, yeah.
And of course, John Donowski, the former Hofstra coach, is now at Duke. And Duke is just, people thought they were going to have an off year this year. They started slow, but now they just knocked off Notre Dame the other day. So Duke could be at the Final Four. You never know.
When does that take place?
Memorial Day weekend. It's at Gillette Stadium this year.
It's been up there a lot recent years.
Well, it's kind of a, you know, anywhere between, say, Boston and Connecticut is a good place.
Where's Gillette Stadium?
It's where the Patriots play.
Oh.
Foxborough.
Oh, okay.
You know, it's a good area to have it because, let's say you have a Syracuse or someone of that, some the north end, playing a southern team. It's kind of a halfway point. And, of course, the women's tournament will be held nearby, too. And Division II and III. Now this looks like Emily Ballinger. I think it is, but she's wearing a number. If it's not on the roster, it says she's number 12. So I'm almost afraid to mention names here because I might be getting them all wrong.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm pretty sure that's her. So.
So what number do you think Emily is? 16.
It's 48th carrying the ball right now, and that's.
Ivan Antonovich is 48.
Okay, well then maybe it's not her. I know that Emily Ballinger is a featured athlete. I haven't seen her out there yet. Number 5.
Mae Blackwell gets her second.
Yep, that was once again, that was a nice play, Dick. I mean, I think it's much more important for the Whalers to score on good plays rather than just running up the middle, which they won't be able to do against the better competition. Or you would think not, at least.
Well, the spreading it around, that's nice. It would be difficult if the score, which is 13-4, had one girl with 9 goals, and then it would be embarrassing. Right now, you have nobody with more than 2 goals, so they're really spreading it around.
I remember one year, this was a long time ago, we had a girl who scored, I don't know, she scored practically all of our points, but she had a bad case of not wanting to pass the ball.
Yeah.
And once we got in the tournament, you know.
They shut her right down.
It came back to bite us, yeah.
First half is winding down, minute and a half to go. It's been all you on the Nantucket Whalers.
Mia Blackwell operating up top, feeds it inside of number 26. I have that, it's Natalie Gammons.
And she tried to do a little slip shot there, and I guess you have to give the goalie a save on that, is it?
Natalie picks up her own missed shot, gets it behind the goal. Now, once again, this to me is interesting to see. Watch the cutting game, get the ball moving better. There you go.
Oh boy.
That's a nice bounce shot.
Natalie Gammons.
So, what when it gets to a slaughter, what is the number? Do you know what it is, Dick?
We'll see if we find out at halftime if there is. I'm not sure there is a slaughter rule.
I don't think there is. Really, what would it be? It would be running time.
Yeah.
That's what it is. What's running time anyway?
No, it stops. I mean, during the game, like right now.
It stops right now.
After goal.
I mean, could you keep it running after the goal? That would. We'll see. We'll see if we can find out.
In the boys' game, it's a 10-goal lead in the fourth quarter, and they make it running time, except for after goals.
Okay.
That goal is brought to us by Cape Air. Fly to Boston, $99. Give them a call, 800-CAPE-AIR.
Well, it's operating up top. Now, that's a good play there. She easily could have shot that ball and shot that and maybe scored. But let's get it behind instead, work on our stick skills, work on our cuts and picks.
Exactly.
Now, they don't use the end line back there as the boys do. That ball went over the end line. She just picked it up and continued playing. So that was interesting. So they're using the sidelines, but they're not using the end line.
I think they use the sidelines because as a safety issue because the fences are here, you know.
So you could technically go back up to the bus there and fire it back in?
I don't think so.
Yeah, well, I mean, technically you could, but the refs aren't going to allow that.
that'd be like the Larry Bird magic shot. Off the bus. Over to the field house and in. We've played one half here in Nantucket with a 14-4 lead. We'll be back with some halftime stats and second half action.